This is a 7-segment display. The device consisting of 7 segments, which enable us to read binary numbers, the language of computers. So in this video, we'll explore the necessary circuits to neatly show binary numbers using these devices, as well as explore the underlying mathematics in simplifying circuits. First, the 7-segment display has 9 input pins. 7 of these are connected to each segment and allow it to be disabled once current is flowing through it. One of these is a decimal point, and the last one is ground for all segments. As you saw in the last video, we can encode numbers in binary, a system of counting where instead of using a normal 10 digits, we use only zeros and ones. Our goal now is to use these zeros and ones to make some sort of circuit that can output a number on our 7-segment display. Let's start off simple with just one display. Then all the numbers we can represent are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. The highest of these is 9, which is 100 in binary, so we'll need at least 4 bits to encode every digit. This is where it gets tricky. We have 4 bits of input data, and somehow we want to get out 7 bits of output data to see which segments should be lit up. The simplest thing to do is to simply put our information in a table, with our inputs on the left and the required outputs on the right. This becomes a lot easier when we give everything names, so we can name them A to G. Now we simply write down the correct outputs, but we have a problem. In the last episode, we had a simple circuit containing only one or two inputs and a simple gate, such as the AND gate or the OR gate. But here, we don't have such a simple logic gate, so what do? Lucky for us, mathematicians have already solved this for us with simple algorithms which can give us results in the product of sums form and the sum of products form. They allow us to find the equation for any output and goes as follows. Let's say we have three inputs, A, B and C, and some output which we want to find, which is Z. Look at all of the cases when Z is 1. We can write these cases using something called a min term. This is a product for all of our inputs, possibly with some NOT gates. Here are all of the min terms of our circuit. What is great about these min terms is that there are only 1 in one specific case and 0 in all of the other cases. Which means that for our output, we can just add the corresponding min terms. This right here is the sum of products form, or SOP for short. And by following this same procedure, we can find the equation to any output. A similar method is to use something called max terms. In this case, instead of looking at when the output is 1, we look at when it is 0. We then write down our max terms and multiply all of them together. Now we have the product of sums form, a similar method you can use when the output has very few zeros in it. Now that we have the tools to find any output, let's finally figure out the equation for every single one of our segments, A to G. Well, that is pretty messy, but it doesn't actually have to be this way. There exists a way to go from these complicated, messy equations to simpler, simplified form. Before we do, we have to figure out some basic rules of manipulating these kind of equations. The algebra where the only allowed values are 0 and 1 is called Boolean algebra. Here, I will only give the necessary information to simplify equations. Our first few rules probably seem obvious. First, we have that anything times 1 is itself. So b times 1 is simply b, whatever b might have been. Second, anything times 0 is 0. So some variable a times 0 is always 0, no matter what a is. Third, anything times itself is itself. So a times a is just a. Okay, simple so far. But let's now add multiple variables. First of all, when you multiply variables, the order doesn't matter, so a times b is just b times a. Second, when you have a sum of two products, you can factor out one of the variables. Third, we have this weird rule, where if you multiply a by a sum of itself and some other variable, b, then the outcome will always be a. Just think about it. If a is 0, the whole product is 0. If a is 1, this sum is just 1, and the answer will be 1 as well. And finally, perhaps our weirdest rule is De Morgan's law, which states that multiplying some elements and then taking their inverse is the same as the sum of all of their inverses. You might have noticed that I mostly talked about multiplication and barely about addition. but it happens to be the case that our alpha rule still work if we replace multiplication with addition and zeros with ones and vice versa. So with all of that in mind, let's now use these rules to simplify some equations. Here, we can factor out a not a, and this inside is always 1, so our simplified solution is just not a. For this one, you can see that there's a common term with not a times b, which we can factor out. Then by the same logic, this term is again just a 1, and we get not a times b. Here we can factor out the a again, and we get this 1 here. If you remember, 1 plus anything is always 1, so we just get an a. Here we can use De Morgan's law to break up this not a b, to simply get two separate terms, not a and not b. These terms can be simplified, and we just get not a plus not b. All of that being said though, it's probably simplest if you just put your equations in some circuit simplifier. But now let's get to our final challenge of the 7-segment display. We're using the circuit simulator, Logisim Evolution. I can simplify all of the equations and make one big circuit. Here we fill in the table with the values we showed at the start of the video. Then we press Build Circuit. Now all we have to do is just connect some inputs, and there we have it. We can give the machine some input with these dip switches, giving us all of the outputs we wanted. Let's go through them. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. How about going even higher than this? Well, we have some problems. As you can see in the number 10, we need at least 2 digits to represent this, meaning that our binary number should somehow be split into 2 4-bit numbers. So a number like 75 in decimal should be broken up into 8 bits. The first 4 represent the 7, and the next 4 represent the 5. This system of representing numbers isn't just binary, it's called binary coded decimal, or BCD for short. Now all we have to do is turn binary numbers into binary coded decimal. The way we do this is called the double dabble algorithm. The basic idea is to just count up from 0 to 9, but afterwards, instead of adding 1, we want to add 6 as well. This way we get the 10 we wanted. Let's put our inputs on the right here. We'll keep moving the input forward to the BCD number. So here moves a 1, then a 0, then a 1. The number we have here is a 5, so we know that the next number will either be 10 or 11. Either way, we have to add our 6. Because it's easier, we'll simply add 3 right now, before shifting the whole number. So we get 10001. Now we just shift and get our whole BCD number. We're done. Now what we have to do is make our double dabble algorithm chip. As always, just make a truth table first. If the first 4 digits are below 5, we don't change anything, but otherwise we add 3. As before, we just simplify the logic equation and get this for our chip. So now for the actual circuit. We can first shift 2 places, since it won't change. But afterwards, we might have added a 3, meaning that we put our add 3 chip here. When we shift again, we might have added a 3 as well, so we add another chip. Do this another time, and add a 3 chip. Now there are 2 positions where this adding 3 algorithm might have changed the outcome, so we connect 2 of our chips in this case. This process can just be repeated as many times as we like, simply add more chips to handle more bits. Connecting everything, we can try it out. Let's try 1001, which is 9 in decimal. Now let's try 10101, which is 21. How about 11111, which is 31. So now you've learned how to read binary numbers using 7-segment displays. But have you ever wondered how you can combine this with circuits remembering values? Click on this next video to find out how computers remember.